Charles Hackler, a company called YahooDB, a open source NoSQL database. I've given a few presentations here before. I really appreciate you guys coming out. It's going to be novel. It's going to be a good time. Unfortunately, none of my other presentations that I actually described was YahooDB was. So at this talk, we're going to try to figure out what YahooDB is and why you might care. I will say this talk is kind of more geared for the programmers in the audience. I don't know if you have any programmers. Okay, we'll look at something out of this. The plan is to talk about what YahooDB is, and then, you know, we suggested I do why you should use YahooDB first, but, you know, who has time for all that theory stuff. We're going to talk about how to use it first and why you would use it. I have a demo. If I have enough time at the end, I will say that generally my presentations are a bit shy of an hour, so please feel free to interrupt me with questions, comments, concerns, whatever you can think of. Technical questions are appreciated. I love answering those. They're a good time to have by all. All right, so YahooDB. The most basic level, it's a database. It's a hierarchical key value store. I'm sure many of you have heard of key value stores before, MongoDB, Redis, MongoDB. The thing that makes us a little bit different is that hierarchical keyword, right? So in addition to having a key has a value, a key can also have a list of children associated with it. So this allows you to store data in two dimensions, which results in some more interesting schema stuff, right?
So that will be similar to PEC system.
To what?
To the PEC system.
Monks. Yes, you know monks?
Well, I have read.
Alright.
I don't want to deal with it.
So, funny story about that. We'll get to it in a minute. So YahooDB, the other key notable feature about us is we're an in-process memory database. So rather than going through a stack in order to store data on the database, you just write stuff to the memory. And YahooDB kind of makes sure it gets rid of disk and consists of the journaling files and replicated off the host and all that jazz. Right, so as far as you're concerned, YahooDB is a library that runs in the process space of your application, meaning super low latency, super fast writes, right? It is still safe to use us in multi-process and multi-threaded environments, and then on top of that, you can use us in a bunch of different programming languages, which I think are on the...
So, yes. SQLite is also in process.
Yes.
But SQLite, there's tons of trade-offs. The things you just mentioned are the trade-offs, right? Like we have multiple processes and blocking's a mess and running multiple things. That's what you get around.
So YahooDB's design from the ground up, which we'll talk about the history a little bit since somebody asked. YahooDB originally started as Graystone Technology Mumps, our code base back in the 1980s. And the design of that system was such that a process is both long living and one process equates to one interactive user session. So we have to coordinate between our processes to handle the locking and the communication between them. What we do is we share memory settings, like system 5 IOC stuff, where the kernel just changes how things map in memory. And I think what I got in the question...
So if there's not a YahooDB
No, there is no D. Which I think is on the next slide. Sure, no sockets.
Is relational,
isn't it? Yes, SQLite is relational. We're not traditionally relational. We are working on a relational query engine on top of YahooDB, but you don't need that order to run. We can handle locks beautifully. We know that we can scale to tens of hundreds of thousands of processes. And threading-wise, I mean, we support Go as a programming language. If anybody has used it, they know that the language is all about threads. So we know it's safe there. The processes, when they communicate to each other, they share mutexes to lock certain aspects of the shared memory segment as they're updating it, but there's not a whole lot of overhead for communication between them, right? And it's just updating, from a process perspective, a block of memory. It's exactly like writing to an array. I don't know, Walt, if I answered your question or if I totally overlooked it.
No, you did.
Okay. All right. Anybody else have any questions? All right. So I'm going to keep pushing along, and we will fly through this in no time. It will not take an hour. All right. So YanaDB supports at least four languages that we at YanaDB support, and then we have community members write wrappers in other languages. Currently, our big languages that we support are C, Go, Rust, and M. M stands for Mumps, but it's part of our lineage. Gravestone Technology Mumps, GTM, which is the code base we fork from, has been open source since the, I believe, mid-2000s, under an AGPL v3 license. So you can still use YanaDB as a Mumps engine if you are so inclined. And you can access the data which you manipulate in Mumps and any of these other languages. For those of you who don't know about Mumps, it's a programming language developed by the Massachusetts hospitals in the 1980s. What it's good for is healthcare applications. The data store is very closely tied to the language itself. So as an example, there's no explicit typing. What you do is you just set a value in a database, and then you can access it transparently. Through a language construct, you just put a little caret in front of a global versus a local doesn't have that caret. Right? So there's no get the value, set the value that you might see if you're using a SQL database or if you're using MongoDB or something like that. So what we're trying to do is take that data model, which has worked very, very well for Mumps, and expose it to other languages. And we know it's worked very well for in Mumps because we know Mumps is still in use today, despite some people maybe having strong opinions about it. So we know that it's been hard to displace because it's a very effective model. And that's what we hope to expose to C, Go, Rust, Perl, JavaScript, /Node.js. Next up on our list is Python. We're open to contributions if anybody wants to help us with that. We don't have any Python experts in house, so we have some people here know about Dunder T methods and all that shit.
I'll have my people talk to your people.
All right, have your people talk to my people. We'll figure it out.
Actually, the rest, you might as well just include the rest of the plug in that as well.
The
rest of the plug, especially since Walt kind of, well, explained like half of it there.
Looking to be available in the job market, and he's damn good with Python and Perl.
Alright, I'll mention it.
But I'm nervous about this community support needs to seem like it's a volunteer.
That's why I'm
open source volunteer thing? What?
Yeah.
I don't know what you're
talking
about.
Information wants to be free, but he needs to be fed.
Alright, so for now, what I'm going to do is show you guys some code samples. I have two in C, and I realize it's probably kind of hard to see. I see some squinting going on. Two in C, one very ugly one in Go, and another one in Rust to kind of highlight how we have different languages. The C ones tend to be a little bit verbose because it is C, so there's a lot of code duplication. So this first example shows a complete program which will compile the right flags and it runs. It sets a value in the database, all right? And the key to that is a YDB set S key, or a set S function call, which takes a key and a value and stashes it in the database. We have a zero and a null in there, and those are related to the hierarchical nature. So if you provided a value other than zero for that second parameter, you have to provide a list of subscripts. Right? And that allows you to set one of the subscripts data. And then later, I'll show you how to loop over subscripts to kind of gain context of what's going on.
Yeah, so are the subscripts going to be the parent, or are they, you'll get to it.
The parent is this key guy, and the key is, in this example, set to up arrow hello.
Yeah.
That up arrow is necessary to indicate a persistent disk, right? And then each of the subscripts can have, I'm sorry, so the parent can have children. And each of the subscripts, each of those, can also have children, in addition to a value.
Okay. Okay.
What that provides value in is if, for example, you wanted to people this with people, the global people could have a value of the number of people you're storing, and then you could have a list underneath that. So you avoid having to have additional data elements like you would in a JSON dictionary. matter of fact, trying to map this to a big sub-dictionary, you either end up losing data when you go to JSON, or you end up with a really ugly schema that's hard to navigate. Because JSON isn't meant for this kind of duplicity of data that we have going on. But yeah, so when you run this YDE setS call, it sets a memory location, the shared memory segment, because not do any file stuff. Well, it does file stuff, but it doesn't do any network I/O, doesn't send data to the socket, it doesn't do anything like that. It sets a global buffer, which is either memory mapped and handled by the Linux kernel to figure out when to switch that out to disk, or if it's our global buffer backend, we have a means of flushing it when it's needed, when you update something. And then, of course, setting data only kind of does you good if you can get data. I did drop two of the include statements because I want to make sure all of them on one slide. So for those wondering, standard I/O is still included, as is assert.h. But neither of those should be revolutionary for you. So here we're using our YDD literal to buffer mapper, which we used in the previous slide, to initialize our buffer structure. The buffer structure contains a pointer to a buffer, the size of the buffer, and how much of the buffer is in use. And this way you can avoid reallocating buffers when you read in multiple data elements, because our goal here is performance. The other DB wants to be as fast as it possibly can. Right? So the side effect of that is to, for example, convert something which may not necessarily be ASCII printable text to a C string. We have to put a null terminated character at the end, which is what's up with that line after the string. And then we print. An astute observer might yell at me and point out that if when used is the size of the buffer that we allocated at 10.4, we would actually have a 1 byte buffer overflow here. So perhaps don't do this in practice without having other conditions in place for making your buffer one larger. But that would only be an astute observer.
Or one who can see it from here.
All right, so yes, we can set data. The other key function that YadaDB has and try to use us in the natural code base would be iteration. So for those of you who know Python, if you have a for value in list kind of structure, we have functionality which kind of roughly maps to that. In C, it's a little bit more ugly because it's C. I mean, I don't know what to tell you. Rust, we'll talk about later, has some very good stuff for handling that. Cleaner, but basically we offer a YDB sub-next method, which lets you move to the next subscript, and then you could, of course, recurse and iterate over an entire tree of data structures. And with those three operations, set, get, and iterate, you pretty much have everything you need in the database, and then it's just a matter of figuring out how to organize your data so it's not absolutely horrible to deal with. The data is stored in an ordered fashion.
Can you go back to that? What you said earlier, just in general, not even with YadaDB, but I found if you get the data structure right, the rest of the program writes itself. And if you don't, you end up fighting your data structure, and it's a horrible mess. And I don't know, that's just one of those kind of important things that you don't always hear.
Yeah, no, data structures are absolutely vital to writing good software. And we can talk a little bit about the data structures, YadaDB is behind the scenes, which might have been pretty cool, but that's pretty deep on it. So let's see how much time we have left after I go through my 30 odd slides, and then we'll go ahead and talk about deep black magic. So, in terms of data structures, it's a key value store, but the keys aren't stored in just a dictionary, they're also stored in a sorted manner. So that as you iterate over them, for example, iterate over a series of integers, and you know they will iterate in order. And this is valuable in providing context to what you're wondering. You could define a set of correlation sequence, which is a database-y thing. Kind of, instead of saying we're going to sort A, B, C, E, we're going to sort B, D, E, F, G, or something weird like that. I don't know. That's mostly used if you're talking about languages that have more characters than the English alphabet. Please don't reword the English alphabet on me. That would confuse me. The other, one of the other functions we implement that can have value is checking whether or not a value currently exists in the database. So if you want to know, for example, whether or not the user that's trying to authenticate in your web app exists in the database, all you do is ask, hey, does this key exist in the database? And if the answer is no, you can skip the rest of the authentication and save yourself a fair amount of time. And on top of that, Walt kind of hinted at it earlier, but this is a little bit different. There's a mechanism in Mumps called Lock, which we provide to the CSOC, and what it allows you to do is lock a resource, which doesn't actually correspond to kind of anything, but it does look an awful lot like a global subscript pair or sequence. And the way those work is you lock the last element in your list of things you're trying to lock as a read-write, and you lock everything above it as a read. So you can have a bunch of processes all lock on to the same thing as long as they're locking a different bottom-level substrate. So for example, if I wanted to lock the printer, I would perhaps say lock up arrow printer name, comma, my PID. And then I have a read lock on the printer, and nobody can get a write lock on it until I finish doing homework. That's probably a bad example, because you don't usually read from printers. But that's, problem for another day. The other thing that we are exceptionally good at, which finding an easy way to explain why it matters, tends to be a little bit difficult, is transaction processing. And I'll touch on that, I think. Yeah, we'll touch on it in just a minute. So I'm going to switch to Go for a minute, show you guys a very dense Go application. I do apologize about the pain I'm about to put you through. I had to shrink the font to get it off on the screen. Please don't shoot me.
It's easier to put on slides.
Well, that's because the C version. Okay, so the C version was 3 times as long. The Go version is much shorter, but it's still long. So what this is a sample application which transfers money between 2 bank accounts. Now,
what you're saying is the Go application is longer because it actually does something.
It's doing more than just saying.
Yes, it's doing more than just saying. What it is it's launching 100 threads, right? And it's going to have each thread transform money from account A to account B. Now, in the current setting, you can imagine that if you were running multiple threads and I read the value in account A, and then I get interrupted. Somebody else goes in, reads it, reads the value in account B, subtracts the amount of money we're transferring from account A, adds it to account B, and stores it in account B, and then I come back on the stack. I now have an old value for what was stored in account A. And when I go to write it to account A after moving the money, I will create or destroy money for no real reason. Banks don't like when that happens, despite what the movies or idols could be. So this is where transaction processing comes in handy. Yes?
We need to do fractions of pennies.
We
they go into this personal bank account.
If you're going to have 100 threads moving money around, you should at least give a little for yourself.
Here's the deal. Right? We're good for up to like, I think it's 18 decimal digits of precision. I think that sounds right. And then we kind of scrap.
So if you didn't know the scale of the U.S. national budget, you might be able to buy yourself an ice cream after a year or two.
Hopefully not, because then they're going to take my ice cream once they figure it out. That'll be sad.
I'm sure they'll miss it next to the $100 million they lost in Iraq or whatever.
Yeah. With any programming language, you have to consider how you install a library. I'm just going to mention this briefly. Go has a very convenient system for handling libraries. For those who don't know the language, you basically imports a URL, and it will download that URL and compile it for you, so it's quite seamless. However, as of now, this is due to change in Go 1.11 or something, but as of right now, there's no versioning system in place, which isn't good if you're like an industrial company. Not ideal. It's Go, man. Go as a language is very convenient. It's fascinating. But
mean, there's no reason I couldn't point some of the kernel.
Yes. So, again, I apologize about the small fonts. Let me see if I have a mouse. I don't. So, we create a function called val transfer. Balance transfer takes two strings, a from account to an account, and an amount. And this yadidb.tpd, you guys can see, is where we do a transaction. What you might notice is that it's actually a, it takes as an argument a closure as the third parameter. That closure will get run multiple times if there's a collision. So if I read something from the database, then I usurp, I give up my position on the stack, somebody else comes in and does something else, or a separate process comes in and does something else, and now my data is invalidated. When I try to commit it and write it to the database, I get a YDTP restart message, which tells me to return so that it can restart the transaction process. Right. We're willing to do this four or five times. Yeah, we use a technique called optimistic recurrency control to try and make things go through as fast as possible, because usually in the banking environment and the healthcare environment, you don't have a ton of people doing transfers in the same account. They tend to like doing transfers into their accounts, and sometimes out of their accounts, they don't usually care about their neighbor's account. So it's not usually a lot of conflict. So the optimistic recurrency control lets us move quickly when there is no conflict. When we have cases where there's a lot of conflict, after a certain number of restarts, people actually just become very pessimistic and lock everything out of the meeting. Yes, and that pessimistic approach is the default for many transaction processing systems, like TP things that are out there. It performs very poorly, but it's easy. Right? It's easy to implement. It just doesn't perform very well. So once we're inside the transaction, like I said, we read how much data, or I'm sorry, we read how much money we have in the front account. We do have to cast that to a Go integer, because the IDB stores stuff as binary representation of a string, so that you can move between languages without worrying about things like precision and floating point, guys like that. So we cast it, we make sure we have enough money for the amount of money we want to transfer. If we don't, we say we're going to abort the transaction, which is a YDB-TP rollback. We do, we subtract the amount of money that we are moving from the from balance. We set the from in the account we're transferring money from, then we get the money we're, we get the account we're moving the money into, and we add it there and set it. Then, a lot of words. Again, sorry about the small font. I promise this is the longest one. It's smaller from here on out. The last thing that you look at is at the main function there, where we call Go in the Go language, says start a new Go routine, which roughly corresponds to a thread, except Go uses green threading. So if I have four cores, it will only run four threads at a time.
Deal with error cases. We do deal with them here.
What's What's making this database persistent?
What do you mean?
Well, you said you connect to a database in the one case, but...
Everything happens in process space. It's like calling into a library.
So when your program starts, you have no data unless you move data.
So when your program starts, the assumption is that you have a database on your system. So by default, when you activate out of DB, it sets up a database for you in the directory. In deployment, don't do that. You have to create a database, you have to add a map, a file on disk, and a few other things.
That's like connecting to your database.
It's a little bit different.
But that's one more. I mean, if I were in control of one more thing, on one more line.
Yeah.
It's still, again, it's still not an entire screen worth of code to do a transaction or do this. So, does he think it's an awful lot of code?
No, I can look this to perform better, you know, for within its little niche.
Well, it's also a little added to be, you know, and relatively self-documented. So, you know, like anything, it could be done shorter, especially in Perl.
Well, I think if we're in SQL, there's a you can do this traction within the SQL scene.
Mm-hmm. Right. So then you have to put the logic in the SQL scene to check that there's account numbers and the amount of money available on the account is the correct amount. Mm-hmm. You may save a few lines of code. You will lose a lot of performance. I do have a made up benchmark shortly that will demonstrate that, but you're effectively doing three things. Four things. I don't know, I shouldn't remember. You're getting the data from the database, you're converting it to an integer. That part, maybe you shouldn't have to do that. Then you do your logic to make sure that you have enough money in the account transfer. You have to do that, and no matter what language you do this in, you subtract the money, you put it in the database, you fetch your other account, subtract it, add the money, put it in the database. You have to do that, it doesn't matter what language you use. It doesn't matter what library or what SQL. And if you can write your code in SQL, I mean, I don't think you usually do. I think you use Python. I historically use Python.
I use both.
Yeah. You're welcome to try and write a shorter version.
In a relational database, you know, I mean, you probably still do the business logic in your code, but. Yeah, at the same time, I mean, there's pros and cons. From a readability standpoint, as well, pretty readable. The other thing is that, you know, if you actually wanted to do anything with data other than just increment or decrement, you know, you're having a lot of data as well. But this, on the other hand, is a key value store. If you only want to store one value for one key, and you know, this is probably a performance. It's just a different thing.
Yeah.
In terms of, if you're keeping as much as possible of this in your, what are the practical limits and how much overhead are things taking?
So, the way that we represent it in memory is we load blocks of data. The block corresponds to a file or a disk block into memory, and you can specify how many blocks you want your buffer to be. We want to allow memory to exist at one time. And when that gets filled, you do eventually have to, or even when it's not filled, you have to write 30 blocks back to the disk before you get them from the buffer. And mechanisms for doing that, we use we support a few different things. One example of something that's pretty well performant is the Linux async IO. So the kernel would actually take responsibility for returning something that is flush with disk in a separate process, a separate thread. Anyway, you can fit a lot of data in memory. We have some customers who have hundreds of gigabytes of memory on their system, and they run hundreds of gigabytes in memory at one time with the database. I don't know if that answers your question, but I got it. In terms of file, the largest database we can handle, the way it's set up, you can map a global name, which is the first element in our key value, in our key, not the substrate for the global, map to a specific file. So you can have as many files as you want, and then you need each of those files and send it to 200 megabytes. So you can get a petabyte by just having a dozen or so files. That much is shipped.
So I'm going to switch to Rust because it is a lot more readable than Go.
What we're going to do here.
First, you have to install the wrapper. For those who don't know Rust, it has its own build tool, a lot like CMake with your C programmers, or if you're Python, you know the setup.py file. This is how you do that. Although, in this file, in addition to specifying some other stuff, you put your dependencies, and it will automatically download them and go to build it, which is a pretty helpful feature, in my opinion. It's called a cargo.toml file.
Toml.
I only ever see it written on the screen, man. So, what this does is it iterates over all the values in the accounts and sums them. So, I guess if you wanted to see how much total money there is in your account, you would sum through all the accounts you have, take the values, and add them together. In SQL, if you're doing this, there is a count operator, a count function, which would allow you to perform a similar function. You lose some control over that because it just gives you the final answer. You can't perform anything at an intermediary step. Instead, you have to write a for loop for row in table, blah, 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 blah. The Rust API is a little bit different than the current Go API because Rust has, among other things, support for augmenting syntax things, kind of like the vendor key methods. For example, to iterate over something, you have to implement the iterator trait. And so because of that, you can't always have certain error handlers in place if you just use a straight up key like you did in the Go API. So we define this context, which is kind of similar to what you might think that you see in Postgres. I will tell you though, it is much thinner. All it does is store a buffer to put your error message in if you get one. And it also stores a transaction debt. So once we have the context, we create a key. And then we create a variable to store the total of all of our accounts. And then we iterate for each value in the key. So this will move that last subscript from nothing to the first account, to the second account, to the third account. In this case, the accounts have names like checking, savings, investments, whatever, and it iterates through them like they were alphabetized. It doesn't really matter what we're doing. And then in each case, we get the value from the database, we unwrap it, and what that does is validate that if there was an issue with the database, we get some kind of user error. So they can go. We convert it to a string, and we convert it to a string to an integer. Alternatively, we could store this as binary. YadaDB, the values are just binary values. They're not C strings, so they have no characters. So you could just store it as a big endian or a little endian integer. The problem with that is if you move your database to a different system, now you have to import the endianness. If you open it in a different programming language, now you have to deal with how the language represents integers. It's kind of easier to just store it as a string, which I think is something Eric was advocating the last time he gave a talk to you. So I don't remember his experience, but anyway. That look alright there, buddy?
That's what everyone has. That one is nothing. What's the let B equals?
Yeah. Okay, yeah, it does work. So Rust is nifty. One of the things it does is have variable shadowing. So what this does is first declare a B. The type of that B in this context is a vec type. U8s, so a vec of unsigned integers with 8 bits, aka a vector of characters, bytes. And then it converts that to a new V, which is a type string. And the old V, which is a type vec, is now hidden from the shadow by the one in front of it. And then we convert it once more to a float 64, which is a 64-bit floating point. Rust as a language is a lot of fun, but it's hard to learn.
Doesn't storing all the numeric values as characters impose, like you talked about performance, does that what is a pretty good performance in it? Has it read all these things back to purchase credits on the side?
How many versions do you think Postgres has?
I don't know.
Yeah, I don't either, to be honest, but I have benchmarks shortly, and they are made up benchmarks. I will talk about why they are bad benchmarks, but we still, even with these conversions, we can't very well.
But I don't think it's doing those conversions when I pull a number out of the database. So I'm not thinking it does any conversion when it does that.
Database is storing
it's not
scanning floating point formats.
It's not.
It stores it in an Indian format and all that.
In the way it wants to format it, and it may not be what is native to process from.
And another part of this is when you connect Postgres. Unless, I mean, prepared statements, a little bit of an exception, which I'm going to depth about another project you're going from. But you generally send a running across the wire, and it's very hard to years ago.
So it's not doing that even when you're not calling anymore.
Yeah, you do that when we're storing in memory. And the reason for that, as I mentioned, there's a pretty benefit. Eventually, we won't tell you a code that you call in robust API. This is a simple API. A robust API would actually expose some of the data types that we use in the programming language, which hash different representations of the same value and invalidates them. For example, set the string. It says this integer is wrong, throw it out. You set the integer, it throws out the string. And that way you only do the conversion when you write into this.
That's that. But integers and strings in the same variable and it
right.
keeps one up to date. And if you dump that JSON, it picks one. Without any control over
it. Oh, okay. And SQLite is kind of fuzzy about the database too, but most other databases, like SQL databases, are not. You have to say exactly what you're getting. I assume that if you say it's a filter type, you can have to put it in the very, very finite number of functions. Basically, core, you know, get, set, iterate, kill, and maybe check data, things like that. And with just those operations, you could hypothetically implement the entire relational database engine and have proof to back that statement up. So, in some ways, the data model is very simple, which is good. And then, programmer, it just needs something.
replication is a way of moving the data off course, so that can turn any kind of substantial bunch of utility. How are you going to do it? 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 As opposed to many other conditions other than the protocol, the first is on the host machine and the live machine.
So, since everything is going to be in the network, and since the connection to those controllers and networks is going to be installed, function, where does this all be installed? Is there
a patient? I have a patient. Should we sit ahead to the patient? So anyway, replication, there's kind of a few limitations, one of which is a single replication environment can only replicate to 1600 hosts, and each of those hosts can only replicate to 1600 hosts. So, oh no, you can only replicate to 200 machines if you do it. And we have intentions to change that one day, but not really that much so far. Ah, the small version of the picture. Let me get the big version for you. That's horrible. Can everybody see that? It's an old school picture. It's been under documentation pages for ages. So the first box, the top left, application logic, that's the part that's running the same process. That's the part where you're just doing the library access. And then those database and journal files, again, same process, not a problem. But as a side effect of the journaling, we have a thing called a journal pool, where you write each journal entry. And this is both a performance optimization and a convenient way to handle the replication. So once it's in the journal pool, you can have a, not a daemon, another process, which is actually responsible for replicating it all. Because you do want to limit the number of connections, number of open sockets you want to have in an environment. And if every process has to open a socket to send data to the downstream replication receiver, you would incur a fair amount of overhead. So there's a background process who is responsible for taking data from this journal pool and actually sending it across the wire to the secondary. Right? The word source server here simply means it's the guy who is generating the new data, right? And then the receiver server is the process running on the remote machine who receives the data. In this example, you see two replication clients, things, two other machines that are backing up our data. We end up with two source servers. Each source server corresponds to one replication stream. And then, the client machines have a few processes running on them, which ingest the data from the wire right at the disk. Now, this happens near real time. I think our failover is measured in milliseconds should something go wrong, if you have the right scripting in place. A lot of that is dependent on your organization and your processes. We do have some customers who have a failover in like hours because they wait until somebody sends an email to IT saying it's down. Please don't do that. Please have some kind of logging on your database on your production system so you know when something went awry. Something always goes awry, without a doubt. Does this answer the question?
So, you have a process and it's running in the background, but it's
totally not a thing. I don't know why you even suggest such a thing.
Alright, just so we're clear.
Okay. And that's for a what could be considered an optional feature. I mean, no one in production should ever run a non-replicated environment. But if you are doing development or testing, you won't have that process running. Some cases where that might be important. I mean, a lot of it comes from the lineage of the IDB, where a user starts an interactive process, and that's it. Having a daemonless database has certain uses. One of them might be games. If you want to persist game data, and the example I will show later, the demo I have, does something like that.
I'm going to move on because we're actually
not moving quite as fast as I thought we would, which is surprising. Okay. Journaling is another common database feature. Postgres has this, Oracle has this, everybody has this. Basically, before you write a new value to the database, you first journal, I am going to write this in the database, and this way you gain some disaster recovery in case the machine goes bonks. You can recover even if the database wasn't fully written to disk. If bad stuff goes through, like if some malicious entity comes into play and does bad things, you can revert the database simply undoing those operations, right? If you need to see what order things happen, you have a sequence of fully sequenced iterative things that in the order that they were actually committed to the database. And you can be guaranteed that if you just play those back into the database, it will come still back. So you can perform any kind of audit you need. And as I've mentioned a few times, transactions. A lot of people claim to have transactions. A lot of people tend to lie a little bit. We have what we call, we have ACID transactions. It's not what we call it. It's a common term. It stands for atomic, consistent, integrity, and durable. They're kind of a set of promises that we make back in data.
Okay.
easy to use, as in Echo example, guys. That was easy, right? All right. They're fast, they're well tested, optimistic concurrency, cool things like that. So I'm going to show you some numbers. These numbers represent the time it took to set in SQL, I created a table that had a single column, which was just ID, primary key, integer, in months, which is the language I wrote it in because it was the most convenient at the time. All it does is set X up arrow I equals I for I in range 1 to 1. In SQL, we have a file, t1.sql, which has a million lines in it. So insert into sample values, and each line is one integer. For what it's worth, I made the file using
This is a very bad example. Something important to remember is, in the end, it's your application performance that matters. No benchmark is truly representative of anything.
So it took PSQL about 6 seconds to set 1 million values in the database. It took months about 7 tenths of a second. Right? That's setting values.
To read values,
it took Postgres 1.2 seconds, and it took the IIDB about 0.25 seconds. Now, there's some, like I said, Postgres is a relational database. No doubt, as we're inserting this, it's making sure we're not violating any key constraints. By design, the IIDB doesn't have that problem. As we're inserting data from the database in Postgres, we have to parse all of the data from a string form to an integer form to actually write into the database. The IIDB doesn't necessarily have that problem. In these very simplistic benchmarks, the IIDB is just fine. Again, and I think I even wrote this down, applications are more complex than that. Try it with a real application. What we know is that IIDB and its ilk have been deployed in production for years. People have tried numerous times to usurp it with things like Oracle and Postgres, and numerous times they've failed. All right? And I suspect this is due to the design of the applications that are developed around our data model, but also the data model itself being designed.
So are there indices on the tables? Like, if you've conserved, if I had an index, and one of the reasons Postgres might be slower, I don't know how you set up this table, but like the index of that table, so that you could retrieve the 500,000th one that would return away, but the IIDB is not doing that.
Do you have to do
a table scan to find the one in the middle, or how do you find the one in the middle?
with YaddaDB, it is a B-star tree, and we can generally find an element in log n time.
Okay.
All right. With a database. And then there's actually another trick to that. If you're doing a linear scan over elements in YaddaDB, I can't say this word right. Amortized time is much closer to constant time because you keep track of the last element you visited. We can skip the looking up of the element in the log n time. Anyway, and with Postgres, it's stored generally as a series of rows. Now, as I said, the schema for our database in Postgres was create table samples, open parentheses, ID, integer, primary key, and close parentheses. That was it. I didn't create any additional indices. I didn't do anything fancy. YaddaDB, it functions as a primary key because we know it will be unique. There's only one element can have this subscript.
I mean, it depends what you're doing, right? So if your use case was give me all the keys whose value is zero, I bet Postgres with an index is going to do a lot better, right? Where it's got to be, you know, given the key, it'll tell you the value, not the other way around.
It depends on the use case. I will say one of our projects, which is my primary day-to-day job these days, is implementing a relational a SQL engine for YaddaDB, and for that we do have indices, which will give you the performance equivalent to Postgres.
What if you had, so your example is we're just storing a single key with a single value. What if, that's not typically what you do in a virtual database.
No,
so
no.
You have a table, you have a customer record, or you have an order number, an order information, and what's the value for that? Like if the key is, it's order, and it's order number 123, but then could you store a JSON record
what are you storing? So the data that we store in our database is just data. We don't really care about data type. You store this binary when your application pulls it out. If it wants to interpret it as JSON, it's totally allowed to do that. Yeah, whatever you want. That will be harder to scan. What you would do instead is probably store orders, order ID, comma, purchaser, equals purchaser, quantity equals quantity, item equals item. So you have the hierarchical nature.
And I would think that if you're going to do a relational database, like these are relational databases, if you're going to do key value and you only retrieve by key and store by key, then I would probably do key value, right? They're optimized for.
Okay. Last reason to use YaddaDB, my demo is a good example of this. There's no network stack. We have no latency. It's basically sending values in an array. There's not really much to say. I'll demonstrate in a minute. Okay. Any questions before I go on to my demo, which won't last 4 minutes? So. Okay. So this is a.
You put the fractions of a penny in my account.
I'm going to run this with debug code because it's what I compiled and I had poor planning. So it will be a little bit faster, a little bit slower than production code. So this is a ball. It bounces around the screen. It's bouncing around at 100 frames per second. Each of those frames we are recording its x location, y location, x velocity, and y velocity. Runs perfectly smooth. The reason for this is YaddaDB. Sending the data to the database takes fractions of a millisecond. When you send it over the wire, you immediately incur a latency penalty. But, you know.
It's a little shocking.
Okay. Right. Now we have more than one ball running, and you can see it's still doing fine. As I said, though, this is running debug code. So we will go ahead and pump these up. And I will tell you that if you run it in production code, you can easily get 2 or 3 times this number. It does slow down once you get above 100 or. On my home computer, I got up to 1,000 without it slowing down below the 100 FPS target number. And for each of these balls, no matter when we interrupt the program, so if we go ahead, I don't know if anybody wants to try and track a ball. So pick one that you like, maybe that slow moving one, the tan one. And then when we bring it back up, tan one is still moving along.
Yep.
Exactly.
Yeah, we're just looking at that yellow green.
Yep.
Right? So this is all being written to disk.
optionally persisted across the network. For example, for that one, game save to the cloud, this kind of functionality can be used. And if you had journal files, you could roll back to any of the previous save states. And each save state happens once every 1 second divided by 100, whatever that is. 100, thank you.
Brilliant.
Love it. Any questions?
If you need snort.
Any complaints? Too much code.
I was talking to somebody at work and telling them that we can cover this, and there's a younger guy that we've never heard of him on the circuit. This is a NoSQL database that I thought was about 30 or 40 years old, so it sounds like it got up pretty close. If most of us in the 80s.
So YadaDB is like a year, 2 years old.
Right.
We are very young.
Because you guys worked off of DTM, which
right.
is from
So it's debatable whether or not we're older than Postgres. I think I lost this debate the last time I tried it, so I don't want to do it again. I was proven wrong.
But Mumps itself was a NoSQL database from the 80s,
yeah.
you said. So for my purpose, this has good
health. And so we have the benefit of all those years of experience, and the benefit of trying to move into newer markets. Rust is my personal favorite, but Go is our other big target right now. Oh no, my laptop comes from us. Oh, there we go.
There's flush or
at some point you're gonna run out of distance.
No, because we're writing a finite number of elements. I mean, I suppose the journal files is named for everyone we have to run in space, yes. So I don't see that happen on my home desktop where it engages stutters. There's something weird with this drive on this machine, right? On my new home IO, it freezes everything. I don't know why. If there's a Linux server in the room, we can figure it out.
This Linux IO caching is
incredible. I mean, I'll try downloading my author edition.
No, it's a solid state drive. But I'll try downloading it.
The drive is probably garbage, but I think it's.
I don't know. It's a mystery to me.
Yeah, disk flush or garbage collection or what popped in my head. But
you're running a LogFS or your.
I don't mean by LogFS, but it's ESC4.
Oh, now we gotta talk.
Does the product support native encryption?
Yes. Well, define command. What we support is a on-disk, at-rest data encryption of database. We do not have our own encryption algorithm. We rely on an encryption plugin that is often libSSL or GPG or something like that. But the data at rest is encrypted and we need a password. Does that answer the question?
So going back to your example where you said, oh, we're going to look up some users and we can immediately tell that this user is not in the database. If that lookup was being used to also look up some authentication parameters and you wanted to keep those locked from anybody that could view the database and solved it, could it support it natively, or would you have to write it? Would you have to salt it before you inserted it into the database?
You would have to insert the hash password.
Yes.
I think is exactly what
yeah, that's what goes
through. Yeah, you have to hash it yourself.
Okay.
We plug into other languages and we store data. That's what we do. We need functionality beyond that. You have the existing library of which there are many.
Gotcha.
Maybe. I'm kind of related to what you're asking. We do allow you to restrict access to certain parts of the database based on the Linux security system. So what you do is specify that this global goes to this file, or this subscript of this global goes to this file, and only when you can read this file is somebody wanting to do that. So then other users do not have access to that.
You had mentioned Tempest and migrating to the Postgres with Oracle fails. Obviously, that's your customers telling you that.
I can't go into details on that.
So, is it that they, it's not performant? Is that the real reason?
Primarily. So, what we've observed is they usually get a proof of concept out the door, that when they try to scale it up, they have issues, especially.
So Pacific, this was used for medical records. Is this just in terms of its lineage in MUFS, or is JotaDB actually being used in medicine?
In medicine?
Yeah.
Medical record. So there's non-open source examples that I won't give you, non-open source, but Vista, which is an open source EHR program developed by the federal government, runs on and we will exploit, because those are our customers, to several places, including nationwide, small agents in the U.S., but nationwide health systems, overseas. And those are primarily within MUFS. Most of the EHR systems that we support are legacy systems. We have only been around for 2 years, no reason to time.
Yeah.
Support for us just yet.
I looked at MOPS in preparation for today, because I heard MOPS and PIG back early in the 90s. That's the last time I might have seen them in the water beds. So aren't they heading into the scarcity?
So interestingly,
just like COBOL?
It's kind of like COBOL, but this
are people running cross compilers?
Yes. Okay. So I'm going to name the name. Company called Epic, which makes healthcare record systems. They are the largest EHR provider in the U.S. Their software is on MUFS, right? And they are still hiring many, many people because onboard them and train them in MUFS. That means that nobody really wants their MUFS. And we know that.
Yeah.
It's our business model.
In the early 90s, I talked to Xerox and wanted to train them in beta.
Yeah, Ida.
Heard it, but I didn't know anyone doing it.
Yeah. So Epic is also, they're not an open source funded company, but they do have some projects working on highlighting other languages and MUFS. And I know the company sponsored GTM has some languages that can highlight MUFS. And the competitor to
Does it handle?
Yeah, we have very good heroes.
You said something about non-English characters?
Yeah, that was related to the coalition states.
So it has to be English language coalition?
No. So if it's, when you specify a coalition sequence, there's a little bit more setup you have to go through, and if the language has characters that can be on the well, the Unicode solved a lot of the problem, helped to address a lot of these problems.
So, I just as a simple example, I just know this because I tried it in SQLite, in Swedish, there's three characters, there's an umlaut, an umlaut, and an A with a circle over it. Those are the last three letters in the alphabet. So, if your last name starts with an A and a circle over, all the way through the alphabet.
Okay.
And I would think that would be important if you're sorting, like if you're a Swedish hospital,
yep.
And you're sorting people by last name, and can you handle that?
Yep. No, sure. I mean, but you want me to actually try it here on this one?
Yeah, that's one of the things that that's exposed in the SQL.
Since there's no daemon, if you have a farm of instances running in unison in front of load balancers, how does their data become sequenced as one?
The way that you would do that is rely on sharding your data, so there's an interaction between subgrid nodes, and replicating them to the same host of sequences. YaddaDB is not a clustered solution. The reason we're not a clustered solution, we want very fast in a batch processing. When you move to a distributed system, that becomes much, much more difficult. So if you wanted to shard your data that way, what you have to do is some application level logic forward depending on what the request is to get the host. Then you can aggregate it all for analytics or for something else later, but you can't go between hosts without introducing them.
Yeah, so you would replicate 1 to 2 and 2 to 1, you would replicate 1 and 2 to 3, or A, and then A would have everything.
You could do 1 to, we do have something called peer replication, okay, which vaguely corresponds to what you're asking. It's still not great as a solution for cluster because we don't get our S guarantees, so it's only as good as something like Mongo. I don't know how fast it is, but you lose a lot of our S. Which is why
people
use our
database.
So,
performance is something that you mostly work with jobs or batch. Are you trying to get through a large chunk of data?
So, two primary sectors of employment is finance and healthcare. Healthcare, I don't use a lot of batch processes. In finance, everybody, they do run down those batch processes.
Yeah, it's a little bit on this job for about 4 hours because we can't get it done.
I should mention people that employ YaddaDB or our predecessor can usually run on one system that's sufficient power. We actually have a tremendous need for a cluster solution, which is why it's not done. It is on our radar, but it's very long term.
You mentioned a couple of Linux mechanisms that it uses. Does it run on anything else?
So, GTN has support for a bunch of different architectures and platforms, like VMS and Solaris, and I don't know, HPUX, all kinds of weird architectures. Some of those are not released as open source, so we got to be sure we lost those. We run on Linux, we run on at least ARM x86, and there's activity underway, either running on Windows, using a variety of things. Fun. And
that's a version of Windows. It should be with Linux in it.
I can talk about that. That's
well,
a whole
WSL 2, yes.
A lot of people think money is fun.
That's not why we're doing it. We actually have developers who think it's just fun. And then we also
not fun.
Mac.
We don't currently run on BSDs, but we are, as of today, testing using Plane to compile us. So we should be far off from compiling us on the 3 BSD.
You don't have to use Plane.
Right, yeah. There's some porting to a BSD would be interesting.
Yeah. Well, you had mentioned like porting efforts to go to BSD.
Yes, I had a friend who was very confident we can do that done.
He probably just ran out of time or something.
Yeah. His name is Brian Callahan, but he has a BSD email, a BSD number email that they have. And he's on the port team, and he tried it for like 2 days and gave up. So, I blame him.
I would blame him too.
Thank you.
Working containers?
Yep, we're working containers. We have containers on the Docker Hub for containers on Docker Hub. Only problem with containers is you get that to work. So, you, for example, bring up microservices, you have to kind of orchestrate things like that. Containers try to separate out some of the shared memory mechanisms we use. You can't share containers unless you have some special flags in the container. It can be done, but I don't think most miners.
That's like kind of the same issue with people running Postgres and you get really any. Well, in Postgres, you have to do the same thing with enabling you know, system 5, IPC, all that stuff. It's the same thing in Postgres.
Thank you guys for listening.
Thank you.
Everybody.